necessity of repentance and faith, proven by deeds. To them, there's a system of doctrine formed into tenets and expressed as creeds. That's how they do it, like the Westminster Confession, that to one degree or another defines all of Christianity today, professing Christianity. But see, they in their world, a person has to be saved first as a filthy wretch, justified in his sins because he's incapable of doing anything, then slowly reformed as a work in progress, but he never entirely stops sinning because nobody can, and that would be sinless perfection, and all you people are liars saying that you don't. Well, we don't fornicate, we don't get drunk, we don't run around, we don't do those things. Why? Because we've come through repentance, and we've seen through the humility and brokenness of our repentance that those things God hates. And he redeemed us freely over our past sins, our past wretched lives. He gave us the free gift of grace to teach us on living godly in this present age. So why would we go back on that? It's our part to press on, to work out our salvation, to make our calling sure, to fight the good fight. That's our part in this working together with God. So, but theirs is just tenets, doctrines, not a living testimony of obedience and faith against extreme worldly oppositions and distractions and deceptions. See, their world, a person must be saved as a filthy wretch, then slowly reformed, as I said before. And they're still committing the sins in Galatians 5:19 through 21 and 1 Corinthians 6:9 and 10. They're still committing those sins. And I can't help but wonder when they say sin, that's exactly what they mean. They're not talking about making a mistake in judgment or a wrong decision. No, they're talking about sins of the flesh that says clearly will disqualify you from the kingdom. So it's dirty and it's hateful then to tell these people that they're going to not inherit the kingdom, and you're judging them. Because everybody's on the same level. Everybody's filthy rags, sinners saved by grace, including the pastors. So we have to constantly be accused of sin in order to level the playing field. To them, that we look like we're coming from the moral high ground and telling them they got to stop sinning. The pastors won't tell them to stop sinning. The Bible pundits can't tell them because they've got themselves backed into a corner theologically. So we come along and tell them they got to stop sinning, and they have the ability to stop sinning, and they hate us the most, even more than the street preachers, because we're telling them they have the ability to be redeemed through their deeds done in repentance. There's nothing prideful about this. There's no saving yourself. This is a broken mess coming through that process, but he comes through that process cleansed of all filthiness and overflow of wickedness to become a doer of the word and not a hearer only. And it's not likely he's going to back away from that. Not impossible, but it's not likely. See, their concept of Jesus is this kind and loving Savior that walked around freely, forgiving sinners on the virtue of pure mercy alone. Whether or not they were able to express faith in him, it didn't matter. See, this is the faith alone concept that's prevalent in the saved and sin people, in the churches. Some actually go as far as to say that God divinely selects those who are saved and not saved, and you do nothing about it. I had a man write me from Australia telling me that the street preachers go out there and preach that kind of rot, that God has to select people, and you may not be able to repent unless you're elect. Why even bother to preach? It makes no sense at all. See, but one thing's evident among all these people, inside the system, outside the system, one thing's evident, that anybody that allows man the ability to obey God and stop sinning before he receives the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is a heretic, Pelagian. You know, that's the reason the fathers, that they call them, the early Christians, first 300 years, are considered heretics by the vast majority of the professing religious establishment. See, but all that's based on the false assumption that a person can actually receive the Holy Spirit while he's in his sins. See, it's a false assumption. It can't be done. Because of this, these people equate the ability to perform deeds worthy of repentance as somebody saving themselves or trying to self-justify, like a Pharisee, establishing his own righteousness apart from the imputed righteousness of Jesus. See, that's what they'll say. They build that straw man that you have to be perfect as God, and you have to have this perfect righteousness, and where are you going to get that righteousness but from Jesus, and then you got to trust that because everything you do is filthy rags. The Bible says he who does what is right is righteous. It draws a picture from beginning to end between the righteous and the wicked, and who's going to inherit eternal life? Those who by patient continuance in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality. Those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey on righteousness, unrighteous, filthy rags, chief sinner, unrighteousness, will not inherit eternal life. Romans 2, 7, and 8. But again, we get them, the opposite is true. They're looking through these crooked glasses. See, the opposite is true. Since a man is saved by what he does and not by faith alone, which we say 100 times, James 2, 24, he's certainly not saving himself by performing those deeds worthy of repentance in obedience to God, nor is he a Pharisee trying to establish his own righteousness because he who does what is right is righteous, John proclaims in 1 John 3. See, in the Bible, the Pharisees, they were legalists. Yeah, definitely legalists with all kinds of rules and regulations that didn't matter. But they were also religious hypocrites, clean on the outside with a form of godliness, but full of guile, deception and extortion on the inside, like it says here in Matthew 23. So, what do we got here? That's the perfect description of the type of so-called Christians produced under this system of error, this system of falsehood. It's where everybody's born in sin and saved in sin, has every excuse in the world why they continue in sin. And they're taught the whole filthy rags scenario. And that's their excuse for the rest of their life. So who is the real Pharisees here? Like the real heretics? Who is? The Bible says you've got to perform deeds worthy of repentance. Then you tell these people it's not of works. Without dividing between works of the law, rituals, and traditions, and all that, in the deeds of faith is clearly shown in the scriptures. Why does faith uphold the law, Romans 3:31? Establish and uphold the law. How could it do that if it was just faith alone? Why does faith work by love and purify the heart of sin by obedience to the truth? How's that work if man can't obey God? So again, the tables are turned on these people. And they look at us, they just don't understand what we're saying. That's why we can't go into the churches and preach this message. We'd be tarred and feathered if they could get away with that. Hauled out the back door. See, I think the real question that remains when I was putting all this together is what constitutes real salvation? And we have the two entirely different perspectives here. One from the churches in the system where you get saved in your sins and then God gives you His Holy Spirit so you can become a better person through some focus group or book or whatever program they got you in. The premise then is you can't do anything without God's intervention, and even then you can barely just get it right. As a poor sinner saved by grace, so the whole concept of under this salvation, under this assumption, is that He did it for you, and if you try to do anything yourself, you're going to be lost for sure. So, that's the whole idea. You can deceive Him abundantly, all above all you can ask and think. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, Philippians 4. But they can't stop sinning. Can't do that. You can do all things. What they mean, I can get me a nice job and a car and a house and marry the right person, make lots of money, be successful. That's what they think. No. It's freedom from sin is what that scripture is talking about, doing all things through Him. So their concept is, like I said, if they try to do anything under this filthy rags thing, then they're lost for sure. So we have to be lost, hypocrites, self-righteous. Otherwise, they're in error and would have to repent. See, sound doctrine is free from any mixture of error. That's what sound and upright doctrine. Sound means, you know, good and noble and, you know, on good ground, like it says there in the parable of the sowers. So when he says sound doctrine, that's free from error. That produces godliness and self-control. That produces a heart purified by faith. That's what sound doctrine produces, not this stuff. That's a myth. So that's the real question here. See, in the Bible, we see a completely different experience of salvation. We see a person that would never come to Jesus to begin with if he didn't really have an intention of coming and getting free from sin. Why would he come in his rebellion? What's the purpose of that? Come under this lie so you can feel better about yourself? Have fun and games in the church? And a lot of people seem to do that. And I'm talking about the real thing here. He's coming through a season of godly sorrow under a crisis of conviction to be cleansed of all filthiness and overflow of wickedness and a humble repentance of all filthiness. He's ready to receive the implanted word into his heart, like the scripture says, so that he can stand firm on that truth. Then that results in purity of heart. Just like it says in 2 Corinthians 7, 10 and 11. In verse 11 he says, "In all these things you proved yourself to be clear in this matter." It means pure. It's the only place in the New Testament that the word pure is translated clear. It means pure. You purified yourself in that repentance. That's what it means. You got to learn that, folks. Those of you out of the church, you got to learn that. Or you're never going to get it right. That's the real thing. That's the real transformation here, washing, regeneration, and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. As a worker together with God, we find remission from our past sins. Yes, the remission of past sins, the free gift of grace, Romans 3:25. In redemption, through his blood, release from bondage, through payment of the ransom, from the corrupting influence of sin. Then we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, Philippians 4:13. Because we're walking in the light as he is in the light. We're cleansed of all filthiness and overflow of wickedness. James gives you a good description of this where he says, draw near to God. See, the come as you are world means to come while your heart is still full of guile. It hasn't been emptied in this process of broken.